Welcome to ProScan Vignette Series, and I'm Dr. Stephen Pomerantz, and today we're going to discuss rotator cuff pathology and continue on in our series with snapshot discussions of rotator cuff pitfalls and rotator cuff pathology. And when we were last seen traveling east, we were talking about cystic tears of the rotator cuff. And we finished discussing how a cystic tear might migrate through a small rent or separation of the rotator interval and then dissect along a tendon and be seen as a little round structure. And at the end of that round structure, it may flare out a little bit and create what's known as a sentinel cyst right here. It looks a little bit like the end of a trumpet. And there is the end of our trumpet traveling along with the supraspinatus tendon on a sagittal view, highlighted as an oval hyperintense structure. And you can track this bright signal intensity structure on a series of sagittal images. So now let's skip forward to something new. And we start out with this axial, beautifully prepared diagram that shows the clavicle, the acromion in the back, so anterior and posterior to get you oriented, the coracoid in the front, and a series of tendons that flatten out along the humeral head. Now, there are major tendon bundles that coalesce as we move from medial to lateral. And the most common configuration, although there are several variations, is one very long tendon bundle in the front, and then some shorter tendon bundles in the back. And there can be 3, 4, 5, 6 of these. They're often not exactly parallel to one another, as is drawn here. For sometimes, if the shoulder is in internal rotation, they'll curve as they move from medial to lateral. And sometimes they will even overlap each other or interdigitate. In fact, they commonly do this. But for purposes of teaching, we're going to keep it simple, and we're going to run them parallel. If we prescribe 3 slices from medial to lateral, A, B, and C, A, B, and C, look at what happens anatomically. The slice A, which has on top the clavicle and the acromion, shows one major long tendon embedded within the muscle. One major long blue tendon embedded in the muscle. The next slice, B, again looking below the acromion, here's our acromion, shows our muscle with now 3 tendons. And if there were 4, it would show all 4. 1, 2, and 3. 1, 2, and 3. So we see a muscle with 3 dark dots inside, the major long tendon being the one anteriorly in the front. For reference, you also have the coracoid anteriorly, so you always know where you are. Coracoid in the front, acromion in the back. Then finally, we go all the way out beyond our acromion and our clavicle to virtually the free edge of the humerus. And the tendons have now flattened out. They become more sheet-like. You may be able to see a few speckles of coalescent very black signal, but it's mostly a combination of very dark signal with even darker rounded signal inside. You'll also be able to discriminate some of the origins of these tendon complexes. And what I mean by that is they come from different muscle groups. Now here we've only got 2 depicted for simplicity. The supraspinatus, anteriorly, and the infraspinatus, posteriorly. Between the two is a thin fibroelastic membrane, the posterior rotator interval. I've also labeled the anterior rotator interval, which is the space between the supraspinatus and the undrawn subscapularis. This posterior interval may be the site of a small rent or tear that allows for the passage of synovial fluid to produce that cystic sentinel type tear that you saw at the very beginning. Let's keep going now. if we look at a coronal, water-weighted image with fat suppression, seen on your left, most tears are going to occur out here, lateral to the acromion. And you might say, well, why is that? Isn't the acromion somewhat responsible for compression and impingement against the rotator cuff? Well, yes, it is. But not everybody walks around with their arms at their side. They pick their arm up. And when you pick your arm up, the lateral edge of the humerus comes in intimate contact and is pressed against the undersurface of the acromion or against the under and anterior surface of the coracoacromial ligament, which we haven't seen on this particular slide. So tears are going to be over here, not over here. Why is that important? Because one of the major pitfalls in incorrectly diagnosing a rotator cuff tear comes when the biceps exits from the superior aspect of the glenoid and then curls over this way in an arc and takes with it a little bit of fluid. And we're not seeing the biceps just yet. Here is the biceps in a sagittal view. This is the rotator interval, the anterior interval. Back here is the posterior interval. Let's focus on the anterior interval for a moment, the space between the supraspinatus and the subscapularis, which we didn't have drawn. But we showed you the space with a red arrow before. Here it is with a white arrow. In this space is the biceps. So the biceps is actually coursing in an oblique arcuate fashion through the joint. It is intraarticular, yet it's extrasynovial. There's not synovium surrounding it until it leaves the joint. Then it's extraarticular and intrasynovial when it descends down in this direction and exits the shoulder joint space. One other structure to depict here is this fibroelastic covering of the interval, which connects the supraspinatus and the subscapularis and is known as the coracohumeral ligament. The coracohumeral ligament contributes to the stability and formation of the deep fibers of the rotator cuff. So just as a quick anatomic review, infraspinatus tendons flattening out, supraspinatus muscle and large central tendon, a little bit more supraspinatus muscle, fibroelastic coracohumeral covering of the rotator interval, subscapularis, biceps in the rotator anterior interval. Now let's see what happens to a diseased biceps in the rotator interval. Let's get our anatomic bearings again. Here's our diagram down at the bottom showing a medial slice, a mid slice, and a very far peripheral or lateral slice. Somewhat analogous, perhaps, to this slice over here. This is the front half of the humerus. So this is anterior. Posterior is off the screen. The red arrow and the slightly hyperintense area corresponds to these three red arrows and the fibroelastic membrane of the posterior interval. Anterior to this is the supraspinatus. Then another space, the anterior rotator interval. Then the subscapularis. Behind that is the biceps. Now let's follow the biceps back. So we go from peripheral to more medial. There is our biceps, except this time it's not black. It's slightly hyperintense. It's inflamed and surrounded by a little bit of fluid. Our biceps is swollen, tendinotic, or tendinopathic and hypertrophic, with a little bit of fluid above and below it. The biceps also highlighted by our white curved arrow. And then our biceps seen one more time, a little darker now, surrounded by fluid in the rotator interval, still in an intra-articular position, covered by the coracohumeral ligament, which blends with the deep fibers of the supraspinatus myotendinous unit. Thus, it is part of the rotator cuff mechanism. Let's see what happens when we look at this same phenomenon in a coronal projection. Here's a coronal projection demonstrating a small round area of hyperintensity in a somewhat medial position. It might be easy to misconstrue this area of focality with an intrasubstance myotendinous unit tear, a cystic tear, or a sentinel cystic tear, when in fact it represents nothing more than the fluid that follows the trail of the biceps as it comes from the extraarticular space, enters the joint space, becomes arcuate and inflamed, and is surrounded by fluid in this region before it lands on the superior tubercle of the glenoid. That's exactly what's happening here. Let's take a look at the biceps as we move from medial, M, to lateral, L. Here is our biceps. It continues anterior, more anterior, leaves the joint space, and then descends as an extraarticular structure surrounded by synovium. Let's look at what happens in a real live case with our matching diagram on the side. These series of sagittal T2 spin echo images tell the story. It is easy for a novice to misconstrue this signal focality with an intrasubstance interstitial tear. That is, until you follow it along its expected course, a little more anterior, a little more anterior, even more anterior and starting to flatten out, even more anterior and starting to flatten out, depicted here in green, and then finally descending and surrounded by fluid. This is the descending biceps, and here in green is the descending biceps. So it's a fake. It is fluid surrounding the intraarticular biceps that is masquerading as an intrasubstance interstitial tear. So that concludes our vignette on a few tricks that may be a challenge for you. And next time, we'll talk about rotator cuff ghosting, and we'll see how the rotator cuff can be hidden from view when it's really present. We'll also see how the rotator cuff can be absent and masquerade as an intact structure. But for this discussion, we've shared with you some key methods for differentiating fluid around the biceps that may masquerade as a cystic tear, and we honed in on some very tricky anatomy in the anterior rotator interval and the posterior rotator interval. Have a great day. Thanks.